Hi, I'm August March of Weekly Alibi. In our continuing conversations with Albuquerque mayoral candidates, we've got Wayne Johnson, Bernalillo County Commissioner and candidate for the position of mayor, here in our offices today, and we're chatting with him about his mayoral election. Mr. Johnson.
It's good to be here. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Tell us and tell our readers a little bit about yourself, your campaign. What's important to you as a candidate, and why do you think that you becoming mayor is going to change things up for this city?
Well, I think there are a lot of things that are important, but let's start with my background. I grew up here in Albuquerque, Albuquerque native, lived here all my life, except for 1 year where I took a job in Las Vegas, Nevada, doing some production work, editing, directing, producing, that sort of thing, and then came back after that. One of the things I found on that foray out of the Albuquerque metro area and out of New Mexico is that this is one of the most special places on earth. There's no place like Albuquerque. There's no place like New Mexico. I mean, where else can you actually go and live any kind of lifestyle you pretty much want to live? You can live an urban lifestyle down here in downtown Albuquerque. You can live a suburban lifestyle like I grew up in the northeast part of Albuquerque or northwest part of Albuquerque. Mm-hmm. You've really got an agricultural lifestyle if you choose to go that way in the north and south valleys. And it's amazing, or even mountain lifestyle, which isn't in Albuquerque, but it's certainly part of my district.
Right down the road into Harris Canyon.
That's right. And up North 14 and the East Mountain lifestyle, and everything is about 20 minutes away. So it's a special place where you have not only diverse cultures, which has always been a hallmark of New Mexico, but you have diversity of types of lifestyles within this short, small area that we call Albuquerque, or the Albuquerque metro area. So it's a special place, and I want to see it thrive. As I grew up, my parents built the house that I now live in. I bought it 4 years ago.
So you still live in that same Sandia High neighborhood?
I do.
That's funny. I went to El Dorado High. It probably lived right up the road from you.
Probably. But
we were more like Holiday Park kids.
Yeah, so. Yeah. You were up a ways. Yeah. You're El Dorado folks. You were up there in the high rent district there from the Sandia folks, you know.
I always felt the other way. I was like, I wished I had gone to Sandia a lot of times. I don't know why.
But I still think that, you know, Sandia is a great school.
It is. And, it's one of the best schools in the city.
You know, I'm very proud to be a Matador. But my parents built the house that I bought 4 years ago. And at the time, it was on the edge of Albuquerque. I mean, I've got pictures of a snowy.
I remember that after Eubank, it was all dirt roads.
Yep. Eubank was a dirt road when we built. This is 1972.
Right. We moved here in, I want to say, 76.
Okay.
So there had been a little more development.
Yeah, right. Not much. Yeah. But I watched it grow growing up.
Right.
I saw a west side that was, you know, a couple little lights that were kind of the AMREP Rio Rancho to being just a constellation of lights.
A huge city.
Exactly. And some of it's Paradise Hills, some of it's City of Albuquerque. Mm-hmm. But it all grew together. And one thing that we absolutely had back then is an assurance that we were indeed going to be growing, that tomorrow was going to be better than today. And I watched Albuquerque grow quite literally from my backyard. Because I can see from that backyard, I can see all the way pretty much to the edge of the mountains and beyond.
Sure, that's an interesting sort of promise, cultural promise you brought up, that for people of your generation, and to a large extent my generation too, growing up in the Heights, we had the expectation that as the city grew, things were going to get better, it would become more cosmopolitan, it would become more, it would be better for everyone.
That's right.
And now, of course, you know, for me, 40 years down the road, that's definitely not what happened.
Well, we hit a few road bumps. I mean, it wasn't a slam into a wall, although I would say that in 2008, we hit a pretty big wall in the economy and the Great Recession. For us, it was more like a Great Recession that hasn't quite ended when we have high unemployment coming out of it. We had the sequester that hurt military spending and affected our economy. The base puts $7.5 billion every year into our local economy. So they're a big driver of jobs and always have been.
I mean, I just want to get a feel for that. How much does the base put into the local economy?
$7.5 billion.
Billion.
Billion with a B.
I did not know that until you said that right now. That's a huge amount of money coming from.
Absolutely. Being generated by the military. It's not just the military, but it's Team Kirkland. It's all Sandia Labs, AFRL, all of the different missions that they have out there. But that's a huge impact and a huge economic driver for us. And it drove a lot of Albuquerque's expansion over the years, which was both a blessing and a curse. And we found the curse side about 2008 when that military spending didn't come back. As the rest of the country recovered, we just kind of stayed where we were.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's where we've been ever since. That's part of our problem. To make things worse, we started seeing crime tick up, and that's due to a lot of different reasons. Since 2009, there's a staffing shortage of say, at least 250 officers. I'm really reluctant to get into the race. The race to stupid is what I call it. I'm going to put 1,100 officers. I'm going to put 1,200. I'm going to put 1,203 officers. No, that's not the metric we should be using. The metric that we should be using is whether or not our calls for service are being addressed, that our investigations are being done and completed, and that we're getting the prosecutions and the information for those prosecutions done to the DA.
Is that happening?
It's not happening right now. For a lot of different reasons, staff shortage isn't the only reason. You look at some of the things that have happened over the last few years with the Department of Justice. A lot of folks wanted to bring the DOJ in, but I can tell you from firsthand experience as a county commissioner, you can't run a police department with a gaggle of lawyers, monitors, and people that don't really want to solve the problem but have a vested interest in keeping that problem going. You cannot run it, a department that way, with a 106-page consent decree that covers everything from use of force to recruitment.
Well, there's a chance, I think the Attorney General Sessions mentioned they may be looking at all of those DOJ agreements to see whether they're relevant or going to be even continue to be enforceable.
Mm-hmm.
What do you see as a solution, not just short-term, but long-term for making the Albuquerque Police Department not only more accountable, but part of the community and part of this whole sense that we're growing into something better?
Well, obviously a safe city. You have two issues that you have to deal with, though, when you talk about a safe setting. You have the actual statistics, you know, what is crime doing in the city? Then you also have the perception. How do you, as a resident of the city of Albuquerque, feel about your security? Do you feel like Albuquerque's becoming safer? Or do you feel like, as most people are saying right now, that this is becoming a more dangerous place to live? And to do it, you need more than just statements and platitudes. You need to understand the workings of the department. DOJ has made this harder on our officers. They've created, through their mandate and through the consent decree, they've created what I'm calling defensive policing. You've heard of defensive medicine? Defensive policing is kind of the same thing. And what I'm hearing from officers that I talk to, and I'm talking to officers at APD on all levels, is that they want to fight crime, they want to do their jobs, but they're not going to be able to bridge the gap, or they're not willing to go and do anything too proactive because everything they do is under scrutiny. So they're under attack. I call it understaffed and under siege. Under siege by pandering politicians, under siege by a very small segment of the public that it has lost faith in the police department and will find any fault in any police action. So they're only doing what they absolutely have to. And I don't blame them for being reluctant to move forward. And you'll hear a lot of candidates talk about community policing. In fact, I don't think there's been a single race that over the last 20 years that somebody hasn't been talking about community policing. But community policing isn't just a program that you turn on. It's an attitude. It comes from how do you interface with the public.
Years of building relationships, I would think, have a lot to do with a successful policing.
Well, and it's even a little more than that. How sure are these officers that not only this command staff and their immediate supervisors have their back, but the mayor has their back, that the public has their back? You're a lot more likely to develop a relationship with somebody that you're working with in your assigned beat.
Sure, there's trust and
there's trust,
accommodation, working together.
Trust goes both ways, too.
No, I understand. And, you know, I wonder myself, and I have to say on some days, my wife and I have lived in Ridgecrest for 15 years now. it definitely seems less safe than it did 15 years ago. And that was only, you know, 2002. Second, I see sometimes, like, I wonder, there seems like there's less, since the consent decree and all that, less of a police presence almost. I see less traffic stops.
Yeah.
I see less cruisers rolling down the streets or through the neighborhoods.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, you know, is that really just because of a lack of policemen and women, or is there some bigger problem where they themselves are, like, unhappy and discontent with the way they've been portrayed or the way the city treats them? I mean, it's almost verging on sad for me, because it's like, right, that's the one thing we want to work in this city is the police force.
Right. And work well. And we want them, you know, it's interesting.
They do a hard job.
That's right.
You know, the worst. You can't even imagine.
They go to work every day to deal with bad people. I mean, sometimes when someone comes into you, we forget
how privileged we are.
That's right.
You know, that we live in a society of civilization. You know, we live in civilization. But the way we depend on that civilization to be maintained is you have to have people out there actively making sure it's maintained. And that's not easy.
Man. I mean, they go in there, and their job every day is to deal with people. Whenever they roll up to any scene, there's at least one person that doesn't want them there and probably very upset about them being there in the first place.
Right. And I think if I'm starting to feel kind of unsafe about some of the situations and people I see on the edges of my neighborhood in my city, then they must be feeling that too, because I don't think I'm alone, and I don't think it's unusual. I think it's becoming kind of like, wow, there's some dangerous stuff going on in Albuquerque.
And you're absolutely right. You know? And one of the more dangerous things is the Department of Justice trying to run a police department. I know everybody's saying, we're going to hire a new police chief. Well, I would say that the council and the mayor have already hired a police chief. It's called the Department of Justice. And until we are out of that consent decree, or it's narrowed in some way, it's going to be very difficult to actually operate the department.
So say the Attorney General, the Trump administration, Sessions et al. Decide they're going to roll back enforcement of the consent decrees across the nation. How then, given that kind of freedom, I don't see that as inevitable, but it's something I kind of detect on the horizon coming legislatively. How would you deal then with making the police department into something more efficient, accountable, linked, bound to the community, and helping achieve, you know, our vision of a better Albuquerque?
Well, there are two prongs to that answer. Okay, the first one is the issues with the DOJ and the policies that they're implementing, like the use of force policy, which really harms the officer's ability to do their job. Right now, if you have to take someone to the ground, nobody's hurt, nobody's injured in that encounter, you're still going to be subject to a four-hour investigation as a police officer. We're investigating the wrong people. We're spending our resources on the wrong people. Oftentimes, taking a prisoner to the ground for compliance reasons is the best way to protect them, to protect the officer, and protect the public. And we have to get back to common sense policing, not defensive policing. Okay. And that's all in the DOJ. That's all as a result of some of the DOJ.
But I think it's in the, I don't want to interrupt. People are afraid that police will abuse that.
Well, and I'll have no tolerance for an officer that abuses their authority. I have none now.
Okay.
But you do have they do carry a great deal of trust. They carry a great deal of power. When they put their hand on the Bible and they swear an oath to protect and defend the people of Albuquerque, I expect them to do so, and I expect them to do that without any sort of bias, based on exactly what the situation is there. In other words, without excessive use of force, which most of them understand what that is. I mean, the policy right now is a bureaucratic policy created by lawyers rather than law enforcement professionals who've actually been in those situations.
Right.
Okay? That's a huge problem. That's one side of it. There's also a structural problem at APD. It was there 8 years ago. It was there 20 years ago. APD has a very central control model that they use. They pull a lot of the power and decision-making up high.
Right.
In the command staff,
sure.
And they push it down. It's very different over at the Bernalillo County Sheriff's Department, and there's some of that is absolutely necessary.
Is that because you think that, I thought about that too, and I wondered if that's because the sheriff is an elected official and he's accountable to the voters.
That might be some of it.
Uh-huh.
The mayor is an elected official too, and he's accountable to the voters. And it is the mayor's responsibility to make sure the police are doing their jobs and doing it fairly and doing the right thing every day. And most of our officers, by and large, 99.9% of them do the right thing in every situation every day. But you're going to have some problems because there are people too. But let me back up again where I was going. I compare, one of the nice things about being a seated commissioner is I can compare what goes on at APD to what goes on at BCSO. BCSO has its problems too, first of all. But right now I think everybody agrees that they're very well respected and they do a very good job at law enforcement. They're a smaller department, 328 deputies over at BCSO. But there's a different culture about it. The sheriff's department tends to push down authority into the field, and we have to in many cases. And in the southern end of my commission district, there's a place called Chillooee. It's a land grant.
Right.
Okay. Everybody probably heard of Chillooee.
Yeah,
okay.
They're
very unique people, great folks. But when you are down there as a deputy and you take a call in Chillooee, you don't have radio service and you don't have phone service.
Right. I have some friends that live kind of past there, and I know that is one of the most spotty places in the world for cell phone coverage and for emergency services coverage.
Mm-hmm.
And the people are they're wonderful, but very insulated from the larger communities around them, I think.
Right, and they want to be that way.
They want to be that
you
way.
Know?
It's their choice.
I'm happy to take their call anytime they call. I try and be responsive
to
them. But for the most part, they don't want me walking down there and telling them what to do with their land and their community. And I respect that. But the same, when you send an officer into that situation, they tend to understand the potential of things going bad for them. Okay, if they get out there and they get into some trouble with someone, it's going to be 30, 45 minutes before they have any backup. Have the same situation in the city of Albuquerque. Then you've got 3 or 4 minutes till you have backup, and probably every officer in the city, and that's the way it should be. But it tends to change your mindset. You tend to go in a little bit better at engaging somebody and talking them down and listening to them and gaining compliance verbally without having to use force. So it's a mindset. The sheriff's office, as I told you earlier, also pushes authority down into the field. Last year we had the Doghead fire, and it's the sheriff's it's his responsibility to make a determination about whether or not to evacuate. I went down to Chillooee when that fire was raging in Torrance County and heading into Bernalillo County. I went down with Captain Campos, who's in charge of the emergency response team, the SWAT team, and East Mountain Area Command,
which is in my district, for
Bernalillo County Sheriff's Office. Mm-hmm. All right. We went down there, talked to the firefighters, talked to the people in the field. They were asking us, please get these people out of here because we're going to be fighting in and among this fire, in amongst these buildings in here. And these people, they want to protect their houses, but they're going to be in the way, and we may lose lives if we don't move them out.
People out of there. No.
It wasn't a sheriff. It wasn't an undersheriff. It wasn't a chief deputy that made that call. It was Captain Campos, who was given the responsibility for the area, and the command staff backed that decision. And so did I.
Wow.
And he made that call right there. We're going to close it here. And they came up with the TAC plan to do it right there.
And that type of APS, it would have had to be some division commander or someone
very possible.
Way up the ladder.
I'm not an expert there, but it's a good example of assigning responsibilities to the commanders in the field and having them make that decision based on information they have on the ground. So that type of cultural problem where you're not supporting your officers in the field, even though they're paid well, they're paid better than our sheriff's department that is fully staffed. And this is a good point to make too. Sheriff's department is fully staffed and at lower pay.
Right.
APD has gone from 1,100 officers to 850 or so officers, and they're better paid. So it's not a pay equity issue. It's not a pay issue. It's an environment issue. How are you empowering those officers in the field? How are you, as an elected official, as mayor of the city of Albuquerque, how do you go out there and support them and show support? You know, I hate to use the take a bullet, but sometimes in a political sense, as an elected leader, you need to take a bullet for them. When they do it right and it looks bad, you got to back them anyway because they did the right thing.
Right, okay.
And that's, you've got to leave some of your political capital on the ground. If you're not, then you're not leading, okay? And they lose faith in you as a leader, as an elected official, and as a mayor.
Hmm. That's very fascinating, and I like a lot what you said about changing the culture in APD to make it more effective for policing. And I kind of want to bring up a corollary subject, which we kind of have talked a little bit around, which is crime in Albuquerque. Mm-hmm. Yes, a more efficient police organization is going to impact that. Yeah. What else can we do? Why did this happen? And what do you see as underlying problems that have kept it kind of festering? I hate to use that word, but it seems appropriate. Yeah. And what do we need to do besides better police?
Besides better police? Yeah. Well, there are better ways to police. And one of the things I championed for fire and EMS was what is called a closest station response.
Sure. Okay? Then no matter who you call, I mean,
you get the closest station.
You get the closest station to come to your aid.
Right. Yeah. And that's, I'm a big supporter of that, but that's just kind of the first step. I mean, fire and EMS is a lower call volume than is law enforcement. So it's a good place to test out ideas.
Mm-hmm.
The next step in that system would be having Bernalillo County Communications and the City of Albuquerque Communications linked. I don't say
they're
combined,
are they separate
but linked.
Now?
They're separate and separate CAD systems.
Okay.
There are different vendors for each one of them. But
different vendors even.
When we were discussing closest station response, we also talked to the vendors about how can you share data.
Right, so that one station sees the activity of the other station.
Exactly. And more importantly, August, is that you can dispatch the other's resources. So let's take a fire or EMS. He's on his way back. He's 1080. He's on his way back to the barn. He's a city rescue, heading back to the station at that point, driving somewhere in the north, you know, North Albuquerque Acres or down in the north or South Valley, driving right through an unincorporated area. There's a house at the next corner that has just called 911, and they see this truck going back on their screen. They dispatch from where that vehicle is to that home.
Right.
That's closest unit response.
Maybe lives.
Right. And I mean, everybody wants to see those response times
sure.
improve. That would be the next step in fire and EMS. Then you take the same philosophy that you've got on closest unit response and apply it to law enforcement.
And that'll improve response times for law enforcement?
Absolutely. Because if you've got a deputy sitting on it, say he's on his way to work, and he's 10-8 on the radio or whatever, and
sure.
he's driving through town, because a lot of our deputies, they don't necessarily live in unincorporated
He'd
parts of Bernalillo County.
The guy would have to take
just send him on the call. Yeah, okay. And he would be dispatched, in my scenario, from the city dispatch center. He'd be 10-8, ready for a call. Off he goes to the next call. I think that system would take a little while to set up
sure.
because it does require that.
Mm-hmm.
But that would start alleviating some of those areas around the edges that we've got with Bernalillo County and the City of Albuquerque, where you've got a patchwork of response areas.
I don't think a lot of citizens even know that. They may not even know how.
There's no bright lines. There are places in this town. Do you know the Walmart in the South Valley off of Rio Bravo down there? Have
I
you
know,
seen
but
it?
I don't
you know where it is?
I know what you mean.
Do you know that it is in the city?
No, I didn't know that.
Yes. The city runs down the road.
That's like Rio Bravo and Isleta?
Yeah. Runs down Isleta, not either side, Isleta, and then grabs the Walmart.
Was that a purposeful move that the corporation
That was a Marty move back in the day where
he
wouldn't extend water.
After the fact or in order for them to get water?
No, no, no. For them to get water and sewer from at the time, the city utility, they made them incorporate that area. And so that area is in the city of Albuquerque. Now the response, I mean, we work together well enough at this point.
Look, there was a time,
the county's going there.
There was a time when that wasn't the case.
No, and I've actually been in situations years ago, 20 years ago when I was in the news, where I was driving down Rio Grande Boulevard and hit Comanche or Griegos at that point, and there was a road rage type of incident. I'm on the radio back to the station, telling where I am, and they came back on the radio and said, well, if you're past Griegos, which I just passed, then you're in the county. So now you've got to hang up with APD and call the sheriff's office. That's crazy.
That's how disconnected
it was. That's crazy.
Yeah, that
now,
is.
People might say, well, then take the next step, commissioner, take the next step, mayor. Let's combine them. Well, I don't believe in that either. People of...
You mean combine the forces?
Right. Combine APD and BCSO.
One consolidated police force.
Right. I don't believe in that. I am absolutely against it, and I can tell you why right now. You would pull resources from, valuable resources from the East Mountains and from unincorporated areas into the city on a regular basis that would really endanger those folks out into the East Mountain area and in the South Valley area, and wouldn't appreciably improve response here in the city. There's a lot of ways we can work together, and we should. Fire and EMS, we train differently. We equip differently than the city of Albuquerque because we work in the urban interface area.
Okay.
They don't do as much of that, although they do have wildland and urban interface mm-hmm. issues and the bosque and that sort of thing. But they have even a different equipment than we do. They don't use water tenders because they've got fire hydrants on every corner.
Okay.
Just about every fire in the East Mountain requires a water tender
right.
because we have to literally truck in the water to fight the fire. So the training is different. We do more mountain rescue work than they do. All of our guys are wildland trained at BCFD. So you want to respect those differences. You want to respect the services of the unincorporated area that they need, and you want to maintain that. That being said, we can work a heck of a lot more efficiently together.
To be coordinated.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And tear down some of the silos that exist between the city and the county. We can work together, and that's one of the benefits about me being mayor. I understand the county system. I understand the county departments. I understand how it works. And having been on the 10th floor, we've got the council below us, and we've got the mayor above us,
mm-hmm.
I've had a good look over the last 6 years at how the city operates as well. And we do a lot of interfacing with the city. So walking into that 11th floor office that holds the mayor will be very, very easy.
You're ready to go.
I'm ready to go. I've been training for that office for really 6 years, 6+ years now, because what I do as a commissioner is not terribly different than what the mayor does.
Well, it sounds like a lot of what you said, it's a lot of practical stuff, a lot of moves towards making the administration more efficient and responsive.
And working together. I mean, behavioral health.
Okay, that's an important issue, and that kind of plays into the idea. Is
public safety.
Behavioral health issues. Related to public safety, is the crime rate related to behavioral health problems the city has with the population of intransient and mm-hmm. homeless people that aren't being properly cared for? I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Well, one of the things I've been very involved with is working with the city of Albuquerque to create, hopefully down the road, a behavioral health authority for the middle part of New Mexico, for the mid-region here. I think it's very important that we have something that could be eligible for federal funds. I think it's important that down the road, I'd like to see the state fund an authority on some level.
Hmm.
But it's a place where we can align resources, align contracts and terminology, so we're not duplicating services, and braid funding from the city and the county. County, as you know, has the $17 million tax.
Right.
One of the last things I voted against it,
okay.
So I'm not trying to take credit for that. But the last thing I wanted to do was see that money misspent, which is why, with the help of Commissioner Delacruz at the time, we moved our efforts from behavioral health into the ABCGC, which is the Albuquerque Bernalillo County Governing Commission, and the city of Albuquerque and the council did the same thing. So we have a place where counselors...
Where that's specifically those issues are addressed.
Where those issues... Exactly. And we've created a governance structure.
Okay.
Because if you got a $17 million budget... I can find you a $17 million solution, all right? There's no end to people that line up to try and use those dollars with good intentions, but unless we have a very focused idea of what those dollars are going to do, unless we have a very focused idea of what metrics we're trying to achieve, and we have the capacity to go back and verify that they're achieving those goals, then we're just going to throw that money away.
Sure, that money just goes out the window.
Right. And that's what we're doing at the ABCGC. I'd like to see that expanded. I think the city has been a partner, but not a full partner. The mayor hasn't been as thrilled about this program or this idea, this concept. And mm-hmm. it's something that, you know, I would change. It's somewhere that I believe we should
get the mayor's office more involved
right.
in this particular.
And let staff go to work better with the county on it, work better with the council on it. I believe that that's an important thing for the mayor to be personally involved with. getting into education really quickly.
Go ahead. I think that's a good thing I want to ask you about too. And that's That's what we want. We want to talk about the long view and the long vision. That's important right now, I think, for everyone in Albuquerque. So back to your thoughts on education.
Well, one of the things I've been involved with, and really some of my ideas with the ABCGC, come from a really successful group that probably nobody knows a whole lot about, which is the Albuquerque-Bernalillo County Community Schools Partnership.
Okay.
I chaired that organization back in 2012. We hired an executive director at that point. But the board is made up of the city of Albuquerque, with a representative from the mayor's office and two counselors. It has three commissioners on it. It has two school board members. And right now the chair is the superintendent of Albuquerque Public Schools. It also has UNM as a member. And the Hispano Chamber is on board.
Okay, I didn't even know about this committee.
Right. They're doing great work. And just in a nutshell, it takes a big school system like APS with lots of resources but lots of bureaucracy and makes it responsive to communities, because we look at it at one school at a time. And we look at what the needs are outside the classroom that are affecting student achievement inside the classroom. And then we align our county, city, ABS. United Way is also on. I'm on it now.
Okay.
And as mayor, I would expand that activity. I would actually go sit
so
on
this
that
is something board. That'll this will this is something ultimately you see is this will benefit APS and prevent further talk of let's split the district up into multiple smaller units.
And the way I look at APS in particular is, there's some candidates that want to combine the sheriff's office and APD and then split up APS. I get it. Problem is, with APS, you would end up with three of the exact same cultures, three of the exact same school boards and the exact same issues. So you wouldn't go in and solve any problems. You'd probably triple them. At least triple them. It might be cube them, because whenever you start adding that kind of bureaucracy, you're in trouble.
Problems develop exponentially.
That's right.
Sure.
That's exactly right. So economic development. We've got to talk a little bit about economic. I got really into public safety. But
That's good. We want readers to know what's important to you.
And I got to education and behavioral health and public safety, but I'm not putting them in any real specific order, but I do believe that in order to have any kind of good educational system, in order to have any kind of growing, thriving job market or job creation going on here in the city of Albuquerque, you gotta have a safe community for that to happen. I think every candidate's gonna agree to that. The difference is, how are you gonna do it? And I don't think many of them, in fact, I don't think any of them really have a clear plan or clear idea how these pieces work together and why they work the way they work.
But your experience in governance and municipal governance, that's going to give you what we need to make those commonly agreed upon.
Absolutely.
Because we do see a lot of common sorts of thoughts from the different mayoral candidates, and the question does remain, well, how are you going to achieve that?
Well, and you can have a thought, but how deep is the knowledge? What does the experience level look like? And we've had a history of hiring mayors that have to go in and do OJT. They're on the job training in the office. They don't know who's working on what.
Right.
They don't understand how an IRB works.
Sure, they're not familiar with the common procedural stuff.
Just know where the bathroom is, much less being able to understand how an IRB benefits somebody, what it does and what it doesn't do, what it can and what it can't do. All of those things I already understand, I've been learning for the last 6+ years. Walking into the mayor's office would be just walking into a little bigger office than I already walk into every day. So I'm very comfortable. I'd know all the players. I understand the economic development side of the coin and how important it is to funding education, funding our police force, making sure that you have a job. As the best crime fighter in the world is that you have a job and aren't on the streets. That's the best situation for anybody. Full employment is the best situation for our community going forward. So how do we help both small businesses and large to create jobs? The county's been doing a lot of work with larger businesses. We've done 41 IRBs over the last, since 2012.
Remind our readers what an IRB is.
It's an industrial revenue bond.
Right.
Now, they are more appropriate for larger businesses because you have to pay for all the county's expenses.
Sure.
Okay, or the city, because they can do
as
IRBs as well.
As well. the business involved feel like they're getting some...
Well, the business has to pay for it.
Right.
The county doesn't, and the city, they don't. Yeah. We don't pay for it out of taxpayer funds. So it doesn't cost taxpayers any amount of money. But its primary purpose is a vehicle for tax abatement. So they pay up front to pay for the sale of these bonds that help finance the project.
Right.
And then during the term of that loan, during the term of the bonds, all of the property is in the name of the issuer. In other words, if it's a county bond, then it's Bernalillo County. And if you go look at that real property and personal property online, you'll see Bernalillo County, Bernalillo County. And that's Tempur-Pedic, or it's Admiral Beverage, or it's the Imperial Building, or it's U.S. Foods, it's United Poly. It's any of those guys that have gotten IRBs. You'll see that their building, for example, is on.
And they're actively contributing towards restoring the economic.
Well, and they're creating jobs. They create jobs. Yeah. We put local spend requirements in there for them. And the most important thing is, you go back to again, is they're creating jobs with benefits who then go out and pay taxes as well. And they're paying a pilot, a payment in lieu of taxes as part of that. So it's not like they're getting away with murder here.
No.
They're not paying any taxes.
They're paying to get involved in the whole process.
Right. And what it is on
the county.
Exactly. And what we're trying to do is create an environment where they can create jobs who then are taxpayers and pay into the system as well. So we're looking at the secondary benefits.
Okay.
You've got to understand that level. You also have to understand the small business side of things. I come from a small business. My wife has a small real estate company.
And you've been involved in the media industry.
In fact, it was a small business and is a small business doing media. So shooting productions like this are very familiar to me. But I understand how small businesses work as well, and how difficult sometimes it is for small businesses, because they are out turning the crank every day, is the best way to put it. They have to do the work. So oftentimes they're doing the work that of the business instead of working on the business, if that makes sense.
No, I understand.
Okay. So they don't know to ask the county for help, for example. And we'll do, at the county, we'll do business summits for people to help educate them. How do you use social media? How about bookkeeping? How about international trade? How do I export to foreign places like Texas? I'm kidding, but Texas, I mean, to even Texas, you know, Texas or Arizona or Israel, for example. How do I get a trade partner going?
Yeah, you were involved in, I think, in 2013 in that big trip to Israel to talk about mutual business between the Israeli state and New Mexico.
And actually, I led another one in 2015.
Okay.
And remember, trade is based on relationships, just
exactly.
like politics. It's based on relationships.
If you don't develop relationships, there's never any produce.
That's right. And you can't do that on Skype. And you can't build relationships.
You
get points for showing up. But, and you know, that brings me to another point. You know, you're looking at international trade, but you also learn a lot when you go on those trade missions. The first one in particular, we focused on tech transfer and on incubators. Now, things like Innovate ABQ, which I've supported here, they're great ideas, and they're kind of an incubator of sorts where people have an area that they want, an entrepreneur will get in there, and it's, if you will, I hate to use some politically charged words that mean something different than I'm going to use it, but a safe place, a safe space for them to not only explore being an entrepreneur and learn about being an entrepreneur, but be one
actually,
and then fail.
Part of the market and fail or
safely.
Yeah.
You know, and then one of the things that they know in Israel, and it's part built into their system, both their funding and grant systems, is that failure happens with entrepreneurs more than successes. But they also know that every failure that an entrepreneur goes through, if you will, makes it more likely that they'll succeed on the next venture. But all of that takes time. ABQ, Innovate ABQ, any entrepreneurial effort, which are great and I support, they take time to develop. You don't get Microsoft out of there by next year.
Sure.
So that can't be the only
focus. So that means making long-term investments in these sorts of projects.
Right, and we should be doing it.
Right.
With our ability to do tech transfer, which, by the way, would require some federal work, that I would be pushing as well as mayor. You have the bully pulpit, and I would be pushing our federal delegation to make tech transfer change the way it operates. Because they've got a much better system in Israel that incentivizes the scientists to not only help identify those projects or that technology that could be commercialized, but keeps them focused on what they're good at, which is staying in the labs.
Right.
finding cool new technology, creating cool new technology. The way we're set up, we're saying, all right, you find something cool and new, you have to go take it out and commercialize it. They don't necessarily have any business background. They don't know about taxes.
Sure.
They don't know about marketing. And then we put this onerous licensing fee on them during the first 2 years of their startup that almost wipes them out from the get-go.
So they have no opportunity to make a profit anyway.
That's right. Yeah. Or makes it very difficult. If they don't have the knowledge or the financial resources to do it, they're done before they even got out of the gate. And thus, that technology stays where it is and never gets commercialized. We should be a leader in tech transfer in this country, not and maybe in the world. We're not, because of the way we go about it.
Hmm. Awesome. Well, these are very clear thoughts. And like I said, a lot of your platform has to do with creating a more efficient and responsive local government. Is there anything else you'd like to add to tell our readers about before we finish up? Because I think it's an important message that we're not doing enough to make sure that the tools we have, even though we've got agency, there's something that's happened, so we're not making good use of the tools that are already there.
And we're not working together real well. I mean, there are ways we could work a lot better, whether it's public safety, whether it's economic development, whether it's education, behavioral health. It really doesn't matter. We're not working real well together as different entities. There's a lot of reasons for that. But what I want people to understand is, and this is something I had to do a little soul searching about when I was deciding whether or not I was going to run for office. I want them to understand that I've been there, both as a businessman and a native of Albuquerque, that I've been there as an elected official. The county over the last, 6 years, we've created over 3,000 jobs. We've brought in $600 million in private investment to the city of Albuquerque and Bernalillo County. We've been behind a lot of the things that they've seen in development here. We know how to do it. I know how to do it. So when I walk in there and I'm dealing with issues like public safety, economic development, education, these aren't new to me. And I'm not just giving you a platitude. I'm not giving you a study.
It's your life. And it's your life's worth.
Yeah, exactly. This, by the way, is live TV. So I apologize to the viewers. Live TV. It's live to tape. But we're not editing. So, but I'm ready to do the job. And I'm willing to do the job. And as I was sitting there trying to figure that out, you get a little trepidation when you're taking a step like this.
It's a big deal.
And I was looking and I went, I'm doing this already on a small scale. I'm ready to take the next step up.
Excellent. Cool. Well, very nice meeting you.
Good to meet you too.
Our readers are really going to enjoy reading this particular week's interview.
So, well, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.